Hi everyone. I'm happy that so many people here as well so far with us. So a few words why we are here. Today we start the PrimiPIM program with the first online Zoom meeting. I hope that soon we will meet offline. Today we will talk about the investment moods in the world and how long-term plays will focus in the future. In the late April, we will meet in Holiday Inn for offline meeting, and I hope that this summer we will meet in Cannes, but we'll see. I'm more than happy to introduce the moderator of the panel discussion, Yuri Krivosheya. Yuri is president and managing partner of Toronto Kyiv. Yuri is an active player of international business community and represents also Canadian-Ukrainian Chamber of Commerce. And I'm personally grateful to Yuri for significant contribution to preparation of Ukrainian representation at MIPIM. Thank you, Yuri, for supporting and for being here with us. Among our speakers today are Matthew De Bruin, CEO and partner of Portico Investments. Portico, hi Matthew. Portico is based in Netherlands, but operates in Eastern Europe, mainly in Romania and Hungary. Matthew has a vast experience working in Ukraine, and Matthew, I follow Portico in media, and I see that you are very active in terms of purchasing new assets and developing new projects, so it will be very interesting to learn about your activity now. Wolfgang Gamernik, CEO of Delta Ukraine. Hi, Wolfgang.
Hi, guys.
The company based in Austria with a long-term ongoing story in Ukraine as well in the field of consulting, general design, project management, and architecture. It is really great. I think that many companies happy that such a strong international player is on the Ukrainian market. Thank you for participating today, Volta.
Thanks for inviting me.
We have also Yuri Filuk as a speaker, CEO of Promprilat Renovation. This innovative project is based in Ivano-Frankivsk in Ukraine. It is a true example of both alternative asset and impact project about which we will talk today in detail with all speakers and with Yuri, of course, in detail. Yuri, hi. Thank you for joining us. In case you can say hi, so everybody.
I can hear all of you guys.
Perfect.
Happy to be here. Yeah.
Great. Aida Ferris, Executive Director at Wimmer Family Office, the investment company based in London. Aida, I know that you have just only started to learn about Ukraine, to discover Ukrainian investment opportunities. So I hope that today's participation will be a start for potential cooperation here with Ukrainian companies, and it will be interesting to learn more about your investment strategy and your vision on Ukrainian market as well. Hi, Aida.
Hi, everybody.
And our last speaker, Jörg Bachren, represents Adira Holding. Jörg, you have an amazing track record of managing real estate funds and throughout the world. And as far as I know, the company's management has combined over 40 real estate funds with a total investment volume of 10 billion euro. So it's amazing. Your experience is a true asset for us. So we'll talk about this in detail today. Hi, Jörg.
Hello. Pleasure to be here.
Great. So before we will start, I just want to provide you also with a few numbers. Honestly, I wanted to share with you a beautiful slide, but unfortunately, I will tell this in words and will put this information in the chat so everybody will see the numbers. So just to be on the same page, the investment volume worldwide in general declined by 53%. it says by S&P Global. According to JLL Global Real Estate Perspective, the global full year market activity in terms of transaction volumes total $762 billion, which is 28% less than the year before. And in Ukraine, according to Cushman and Wakefield, the investment volume in 2020 was $156 million. So it is less, it is 59% less than in 2019. So of course the market is declining, but we believe that for long-term players it is more about building resilience and adopting the strategy to new conditions. And of course the strong, really strong players can always find an opportunities in this situation. So on this positive note, I would like to let my moderator Yuri Krivosheya to speak forward. Yuri, I give you a word and we can start with questions. And if I forget something, please add, because I'm a little bit.
Sure, sure. Thank you very much. First of all, I would like to thank everybody, you know, our great speakers and everybody who was able to join us. As well, I would like to actually say a special thank you to Anya, because for those of you who do not know, we actually, as Ukrainian real estate market, are very lucky to have Anya. And without her, a lot of things would not be possible in representation of Ukraine on the market together with Marina and Dmitry. And now going forward to our, you know, great panel and the discussion, we would like to kindly suggest to define a system of coordinates of our first wave of today's session. When we talk in terms of macro numbers internationally, something that Anya already mentioned, there is one picture. But of course, as we understand, it's impossible and probably not proper to judge about Ukrainian market just by Excel sheet or by a few standard assumptions, because there are some particularities of the market. And some of the interesting trends that we noticed before before the COVID situation is that, for example, there was a very strong overshadowing demand in quality demand for quality real estate, and supply was not catching up. Of course, COVID and the current crisis decreased that demand. However, this being said, the supply, new supply of quality demand has not been aggressive at developing either. Therefore, we see a lot of interesting potential for Ukrainian market, which is based on a lot of interesting bullet points. I mean, first of all, we see that finally all the developers and the key market players, they started to think in terms of ecosystems, not just simply square meters. We already noticed that energy in terms of a particular location or a particular property is not an abstract term anymore. This is something that's becoming a magnet for any type of stakeholder. In terms of stakeholders, we see the global trend of some of the economies and markets moving from shareholder capitalism to stakeholder capitalism. And we really see in Ukraine, especially among the younger and younger business generation, really grasping to that concept. And coming back to the potential of the market, it's also people. And while Ukraine has been the country with a huge population in comparison to other European countries, we see amazing trends among young generations. First of all, these people do not care who the politicians are. They're not affected as much by agenda, and they're really becoming super creative, creating added value for the market, which makes the market a little bit more advanced. And as well, we see that everybody, landlords, tenants, and all the stakeholders of the market really start to not only appreciate impact investments and social responsible behavior, but it's becoming a part of their strategy, part of their policies, and is becoming like a set in stone fundamentals. And now it is my great pleasure to come to Matthew. And Matthew has amazing real estate experience, has a very diversified, I would say diversified knowledge about Ukrainian market. And it will be very interesting to hear Matthew's opinion if you also, Matthew, see, you know, a great potential for Ukrainian market and also through the filter of your business activity right now.
Thanks, Yuri. Maybe to start on the past year before we move into the Ukrainian perspective, I think JLL noted that there was a decrease of 53% worldwide. Could be. I think if you look at markets individually, you will see very big differences. If I look at the three markets where we were active, Romania, Hungary, and the Netherlands, and we have a sister company that's doing Czech, Poland, and Germany. And I think you would see that in those markets, the decline was more like 15 to 20%. And then if you would look at where the decline was, you would see that there are big differences. So high street retail, shopping centers, or offices would see a huge decline, whereas investments in residential, investment logistics, and for instance, supermarkets where we are active, actually was at the same level, if not higher. So I think the past year with the lockdown has shown that the market is shifting and adjusting to things that are doing fairly well during the COVID situation. And what you also see, of course, in such a situation is always that underlying trends are being exacerbated. So it's not that something completely new happens, but something that was already sort of happening that people didn't notice too much yet is becoming more obvious. So I think if you compare that to the Ukrainian market, I think, well, you know, last year with COVID was a difficult year, but I remember in the time that I was there a couple of years ago that we have seen something likely, if not bigger in terms of events happening, and the market at that time also always recovered. I think we saw around Euromaidan that there was a big step down in the economy, but if you look at our specific business, the real estate sector, I've never seen so much activity happening afterwards, after that period. And in a couple of years' time, I think Kyiv built as much residential and other new real estate as they did in the combined 10, 15 years before that period. So there's always, I think, a lot of things happening. If you look at ESG, you're absolutely right. If I look at the Ukrainian real estate market from the last couple of years, and also the people and the new generation participating there, and I think you made a lot of steps that I also see in Western Europe. So there's absolutely a very comparable, if not a better situation in Kyiv and Ukraine as a whole. ESG is always a special one because I think on one hand, this is something that gradually you see that investors grasp that they have to check the box. ESG is on everybody's agenda. So we also need to have it in our agenda and show to our stakeholders that we are taking care of it. But at the same time, I think there's now a growing awareness that it is also something that can, in the end, lead to better performance of your company and of the results of your company. So it's a little bit with sustainability. 10, 15 years ago, it was something you had to do. And nowadays, with solar energy and with wind, for instance, you can make a normal return. So if you can make a normal return, it doesn't make sense at all. It does make sense to apply it. And I think that's the same that you see with ESG as a whole. But I think what will be interesting to see also in Ukraine is how it will be applied. Since right now it's not just one topic, it's not only sustainability, it's also inclusiveness, diversity in companies, social responsibility, stakeholders indeed. So it's so many topics at the same time that are just covered by these three letters. And it will be very interesting to see how it will be in the end adapted, and also how it will be adapted in the Ukrainian situation. As I think on one end you have a disadvantage that you see that a lot of this stuff is being now formalized within the EU. You're not part of the EU. On the other hand, it also means that in the EU sometimes things go slow, and it's very difficult to get certain things realized, whereas if you're not part of that bloc, it might be even easier to realize certain ambitions, because you're not constrained in any way by what is prescribed from Brussels. So I think it's a very interesting time, because especially now companies realize that there is the upside of ESG is also there. It will be very interesting to see in the coming year how they start translating that into their business and how they select assets, for instance. So
very interesting.
Yeah, interesting times, absolutely.
Very interesting. Thank you very much for this insights, Matthew. And, you know, just trying to ride the positive wave before introducing my our next speaker. Just for 1 minute, I want to tell you one personal story. A few years standing at MIPIM exactly next to the stand of Ukraine, I was talking to a friend of mine, and both of us noticed that some of the people who came to Ukraine have been complaining about lack of opportunities, have been complaining about the toughness of the market, have been complaining that there is nothing to do. In comparison, this friend of mine and I were exactly on the same page because we had radically different view of the market, because we saw that it's time to create opportunities, it's time to realize opportunities, and there is a great potential for growth, which is evidence people who would like to do something, they can achieve result. And this friend of mine is Wolfgang. And, you know, it's a great pleasure to introduce now again Wolfgang. And Wolfgang represents an amazing case study where somebody supports Ukrainian market not only by words, by amazing actions, and doing it successfully in a reputable, responsible way and with a beautiful culture. Wolfgang, we're happy to hear your thoughts.
I got goosebumps by having this introduction, and at only at the end I understood that you're talking about me. Thanks, my friend. I don't deserve this, but thank you anyway. Yeah. thank you. Well, it's been an amazing year, and it's as it was Matthew said, it's amazing opportunities ahead of us. We are very fortunate and happy and humbled to announce that we have had the most successful year over the last 44 years in our whole group, in our whole group of Delta, in all our countries. It was an amazing year for Ukraine as well. The only bottleneck, the real bottleneck, what we now see in Ukraine is human potential in all aspects. I mean, hiring is now key. Hiring proper people is key with proper culture. Yeah. What we definitely see is a return on Ukrainian investments, on people, new generation coming in, coming back to Ukraine, investing in Ukraine. Our share of Ukrainian investors and Ukrainian partners, Ukrainian clients, increased tremendously over the last year, and it will further increase. And the international investors, which were already active in Ukraine and which still stick to Ukraine, they still stick to Ukraine. Yeah. So. And I just talked yesterday with an amazing company from Great Britain, ready to roll out data centers. And they also said, you know, by having the fact that Ukraine is more and more bound now with and connected with the European Union, it's just a matter of 1 to 2 years when we also set up our data center there in Ukraine. And they are talking about 150,000 square meters. So it's nothing like 6 or 10 or 15. It's just a matter of fact that the next step is Ukraine. So interesting time ahead of us. We see different things which drive us and the market at the moment. In terms of residential, we created a new term which is called HOFIS. So it's a combination of home and office. We call it HOFIS. It will shift, it will change completely the way people will live, work, and interact. Another trend we see is coming in industry and in logistics. Over the last 10 months, the amount of robotics and artificial intelligence connected with logistics has risen tremendously in all areas. So slowly robotics take over tasks which eventually human will never do again, also driven by all these COVID measures. Office, in terms of office and headquarter development, which we do a lot at the moment in all our countries, there's also a very interesting campus development on the way. We are now just, we have not just got the contract 2 weeks ago. It's in Western Ukraine. Soon we will talk about this. So we see that decentralized offices are now pushed back together, creating the home base for cultural development, for interaction, for human potential development. So campuses, home bases, and the way how they interact with the market and people will change completely. Another big trend which we see, and which Yuri and his team in Ivano-Frankivsk do perfectly, I deeply believe, is urban mining. So using existing infrastructure, existing buildings, reshaping them, finding new ways of, for their existence. And this is, one of my last words now for the introduction, in the European Union, very important because, and I think Matthew knows perfectly, from this year on, we'll talk about this, the term taxonomy in the European Union. And this taxonomy means that the investors, companies, and financial institutions have to define the environmental performance of their economic activities. So that means what we are now doing is huge funds from Germany or from Austria are actually approaching us and demanding from us the assessment of their existing portfolio from all over Europe, and this also includes Ukraine, obviously, to actually state how they perform from an environmental point of view. This is something completely new. Nobody knows exactly how this will work. And it's not talking about green building certification. This is also a must-have. You know, there's nobody talking about this anymore. Now it's really hard facts, because taxonomy will definitely play a role in taxation afterwards, in fines to be paid or whatever. So urban mining, robotics, megatrends like home office or office, logistics, retail. Last word about retail. I mean, retail is actually something what I would say finding his own new way how to exist in future, also combined with the online retail. We're not real experts into that because it's actually completely developed in other spheres. The usual shopping mall in several countries, they don't have any place for existence anymore. So this is definitely another topic. But what is really interesting, what drives us is the next generation in Ukraine, especially coming in, developing campuses, developing headquarters, corporate culture, and bringing completely new ideas. And this will actually shape the Ukrainian market for the next years.
Thank you so much. Thank you for this trends and for this excitement and a piece of realistic dream, really. So thank you for that. And from my side, with this strong and amazing messages, it will be amazing to move now to our next speaker, Yuri Filiuk, who is a real founder and a CEO of PromPrilat. And just as a few words, here, among the things that already been said, Yuri and his team and PromPrilat represents not only successful implementation and realization of opportunities in Ukraine. It's really creating new opportunities. It's really going beyond any borders and setting up something in a region of Ukraine that forces international sophisticated large players to pay attention. And the global support of the project right now, without any exaggeration, is coming from a number of continents and a number of institutions by its nature, size, and so on. So Yuri, while being a humble leader, is one of the game changers on the market, and it will be amazing to hear a little bit about PromPrilat and as well about Yuri's view on the current situation on the market.
Thank you, Yuri. Very glad to be here again. So several words about what we are trying to do in Ivano-Frankivsk. We, PromPrilat Renovation is first of all impact investment project. So we try organically to unite regional development goals with commercial or economical goals. And we revitalize old post-Soviet Union factory in the center of the city and try to build unique ecosystem in cross of art, educational development, economical development, and urban development. And try to combine very different functions, like, for example, offices of new companies, incubators, accelerators, business school, but at the same time, art center, event halls, hotel, and so on, food market, and many, many others. And we also try to unite different stakeholders, I mean, business representatives, civil society representatives, and also, for example, office of department investment department from City Council is also moved already to our ecosystem. And that's also unique for Ukraine, at least, when we have this combination of different stakeholders and they try to create the synergy effect together. What can be also interesting, we use different sources of financing our project, but one of the most important for us also is the tool of crowd investing. And for the present moment, we involved 770 co-investors and more than 30 different both national and international partners, as Yuri already told. And why it's important for us, because it helps us to create a community which is driving also and make more sustainable this project. And as we can see, we overcame already two crises of 2020. Both COVID and economical. And now we can see that this ecosystem approach makes project more sustainable. For the present moment, 100% of our tenants stay with us, and they pay 100% rates which we had before the 2020. So we stay in very stable economical situation even with this post-COVID period. And we have increasing demand starting from the second half of 2020 from both investors and tenants, and even more new different partners, which are sometimes are even unexpected for us. And we are looking for new combinations of these different partnership and try to build a new approach for at least for Ukraine, but maybe even beyond. Thanks.
Very cool. And just if I may add something, because of the efforts, something that Yuri will not share about himself, but because of the efforts of Yuri and his team, Forbes did recently a rating, and Ivano-Frankivsk, among all the cities of doing business in Ukraine, got the first place. Because when I mentioned about game-changing activity of Promprilat, it's really the case, because the whole community is starting to feel different in the environment where they are. So,
Yuri, if you don't mind, may I also add, because the story with Promprilat in Ukraine resonates with what I have read recently. It was an article on result of MIPIM Urban Forum, where Wimmer Family Office, Aida's colleague Peter Plot, told that no longer for them is real estate only about cash flow, but it is about creating positive impact both on environment and on community. And he said there that it's also the opportunity for cooperation between private and public sector. Aida, may I ask you, with reference to this, whether this reflects your strategy for now, that you are more focusing on responsible investing, or cash flow is winning?
Well, absolutely. ESG is our focus, as I think it's nothing new said. Now I have nothing new to add, because I was listening to you and everybody was emphasizing that. So definitely sustainable products, impact investing. I must say we can afford to be more spoiled at the moment. So we expecting obviously ESG focus, but we do look at the result on the end. So we expect very high IRRs, much higher than pre-COVID, obviously with ESG, environment and governments and transparency and everything that goes with it. So.
It's great. Coming back to this particular approach and your investment strategy, if you can, please share with us your view on the Ukrainian market and some of the maybe elements of your investment appetite.
Well, I must say, since COVID, we are a little bit more cautious, a little bit more focused on mature markets and stable markets, let's call it, simply because there is lots of opportunities everywhere at the moment, thanks to COVID. Ukrainian market, obviously the project always speaks for itself, and we would consider, but we would still expect a little bit more of political stability, legal system to be sorted out a little bit. We would be a little bit cautious, I must say, but as I said, we are open to the project. Really, it's a project and people behind it that drives us, rather than everything else. So yeah, we are family office, so it's very kind of personal. It's a feeling as well, but we are a bit cautious of your political stability and your legal system, I must say.
So
go ahead, Anya, sorry.
Okay, given that you are project oriented, could you just specify what are criteria for this project?
What are criteria? Well, we change as the market change, but obviously it's obvious now that we more focus on residential. Residential, we still go for mixed use, depends where it is, what it is. We are even investing in hotels in Maldives right now, which we cannot call mature market, but they handled COVID very well. The whole world was there. We know that luxury now still is not being affected as bad, and it's not going to be affected as bad as other markets. So it's really IRRs, it's stability, it's residential, I would say, on the first place. Obviously, we've never done much of the retail anyway. Offices less, not because of the impact of COVID. I think it will pick up. It will just change the way it's done. But really residential, and we still are investing in hotels, but luxury at the moment. So. And high IRR, really, we expect minimum 20% of unlevered IRRs.
It's very interesting.
On the cost of the project, not on equity only. Mm-hmm.
If I may just add, I mean, of course, we see that a lot of investors are and may share the same concerns. But if I may add a little bit of a positive flavor, many Ukrainian representatives of the Ukrainian real estate market and businesses in general, while understanding some of the hurdles, they're already becoming creative in terms of how to overcome. One of the concrete examples we just heard about from Prilat, where basically they were not waiting until the environment will become better. They are changing the environment, and they become the exceptional example. And despite the situation in the country, they're getting again a global support. And we see there are those positive exceptions keep on popping up. And by this thesis, I just would like to underline that there is a potential for Ukrainian interesting projects and for future trends. And if I may, moving to Jörg, as we understand from your very strong experience in real estate market, your knowledge about Ukraine, and as we can see from your portfolio, we understand that you possess significant market intelligence, because you may see how your portfolio is behaving, how different representatives tackle different situations. And of course, your market intelligence and probably big data can show some different angle towards what we've been discussing, or maybe the same. It will be interesting to hear, your insights as well.
Well, thank you very much. Of course, we have to, consider any investment in two different ways. At the moment, of course, there is more focus, and this is my experience, what I have right now, more focus on residential, because of this corona crisis, everybody wants to move into other apartments, bigger apartments. And that's why, the the activity was quite heavy towards residential construction. Yeah, I'll give an example. When we enter, let's say, different markets, of course, we consider also different investment views. Do I want to, let's say, buy, build, and sell? Or do I want to stay for a long term? Yeah, so there are different views. If I go into buy, build, and sell, there's usually the residential part, because if there is a buyer market and not a rental market, then of course you are sure that you can go into a very quite easy exit. Yeah, you buy land, you build apartments, you sell them out. Yeah, if you go for a long hold strategy, you usually don't do that when you go abroad. Yeah, you just, because it's too far away and too, let's say, complicated to handle that. If you just have a portfolio of apartments somewhere in the world, it's easier to have than, for example, offices, yeah, logistic, which is a big trend in the moment, even in Germany, or maybe then retail, yeah, which is also quite complicated. Hospitality, I think it's a dead market at the moment. Yeah, so you can find very good opportunities to buy very distressed hotels. Yeah, but if they will come back, well, I doubt it will definitely last a long time. So there is a different view from investors. Yeah, at the moment, I have the experience that investors go more into stable investments, long hold investments, and not in short term. So it means not in buy, build, and sell. They do in some markets, yeah, for example, in India. For long haul, they go definitely still go into offices, not that much anymore, but also in stable markets, into residential for a long term. Yeah. So this is what I can, and I can absolutely, I agree also with Wolfgang, what he said. A big focus is now on the typical ESG, which means environmental and social and governance. So some even they restructure their portfolios towards exactly to this point. There is even a law in the European Union. Surprise, surprise. We have everything, a law for everything. And so this is a big issue and a big point right now. So impact investing and investing into towards environment, social and governance.
Great. So thank you for this.